There's no PowerPoint tonight. You'll be turning in your Bibles, though, to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10 is where we're going to take our lesson this evening. I was scared today. I finally did pull up the YouTube and saw I had 33 people had watched it. So I got my numbers. I'm a new YouTube boom, I guess. It was probably most of y'all just watching it again. But it's neat. I appreciate all the people. I know Brian and Sean have worked hard to try to keep us going with technology. I had to listen to Alan in my car this morning, testing, make sure the radio station worked. And it's amazing what we can do. But I'm still loving the singing. It's just, I don't know, maybe we took it for granted. And now all of a sudden you just hear the beauty of it, the sound of it. It's been amazing. And it's just so good to be back. In Luke chapter 10, following up this morning's lesson and left a few things off intentionally because I wanted to follow up tonight with a parable of Christ called the Good Samaritan. So if you want to go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Luke 10 and look at verse 25, I'll be reading the entire parable at first and then we'll go from there. Beginning verse 25 of Luke 10, it says, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? How do you read it?' And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said unto him, 'You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live.' But desiring to justify himself, he said to Jesus, 'Who is my neighbor?' Jesus replied, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, and pouring oil and wine, then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." Before we even start looking a little deeper, we need to look at our characters, and the main one I'm going to focus on is the Samaritan. Back when the Assyrian captivity came along, all the Jews were taken back to the capital of Assyria and used as slaves. There were some, though, that were left behind. The elderly, weak, those that were sick, those they thought would not be of any value to them were left. Those people eventually intermarried with Gentiles. They still believed in God, but they had kind of changed some of the laws and rituals and traditions that they had, and were kind of worshiping him in their own way. When the Jews came out of captivity and came back home, and they saw what these people had done, they condemned them. Over time, and we're talking hundreds of years before Christ, the hatred between these two was so bad that it was said that Jews would not even travel through Samaria. But if they needed to journey and get to the other side, they would go around Samaria so that they would not have to encounter a Samaritan. They looked at them and actually called them dogs. That's how bad the hatred between these two groups were. So now as we're looking at him, and the man who answered said, "You know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." That almost seems like a contradiction, doesn't it? We're talking about the love we're supposed to have for God. And basically what it's saying is you love him with everything you have. And then all of a sudden on the end it says, "And love your neighbor." But you see, you can't love God, as we talked about this morning, truly love him with all that you have and hate your neighbor. Well, it says the lawyer wanted to justify himself. Who is my neighbor? Because it'd be really easy. Matter of fact, we'll look at scripture a little bit and show you that people had separated. And we're good at that. We start claiming, well, my neighbor is that person I like. It's the person I get along with. My neighbor is my friend. My fellow Jew probably is how they looked at it. So Christ pulled out the perfect example of who the Jews could not stand, a Samaritan. But you see, he threw in two other characters, a priest and a Levite. This morning we talked about how Christians should live, what God expects of us to do in our lives. And I said what we should do is because we don't always do. We don't always represent God with the love, with the humility and compassion that we should. But he took priests, said he saw this man laying on the side of the road. Now the priests, these are the Jewish leaders. This is a Jewish man laying there. Of all the people who's going to have compassion on a fellow Jew, obviously is going to be the priest. He looked at him, saw him. I don't want anything to do with that. Have you ever felt that way? Well, I don't want any of that. That's going to be more trouble than I want to get into. I don't even know him. He passed by the other way. I remember one time we were coming to church, this was many years ago. We saw someone, it looked like a soldier or something, that was working on his car. I'm a tunnel vision guy. And Jenny thinks that being here 30 seconds before church starts is on time. I think that's late. So I'm trying to get there, and she says, hey, I think he needs help. Well, I'm still tunnel vision. I've got to get to church. And she hit me and said, Greg, I think he needs help. Got back and dinner, but you went back, and sure enough, he needed help. He was trying to get back to Clarksville's his post. So I was a little late for church. But what do you think made God happy? Well, it probably made him happy that Jenny paid attention, but Greg didn't. But don't you think he'd rather me be a little late for church and help somebody out? It ended up one of our members drove him to Clarksville, volunteered, and said, I'm driving home. One of the members here drove him to Clarksville, helped him out, and met him the next day when he came back to get his truck. Now, what kind of impact do you think that made? When Little Sturgeon Creek Church of Christ had its members drive this man from Smyrna all the way to Clarksville, it's a good hour and a half from here, and then all the way back home. It had an impact. Loving our neighbor as ourselves, that's what God's wanting, is us to show the same love that we're supposed to be showing towards God, towards everyone. Well, the next character was a Levite. And if you know Jewish history, you traveled Levi, that was that special. Only your priests came from that. Only the Levites could be the ones back in the old law that could touch the poles and carry the Ark of the Covenant. They were high ranked. All right? So you could have called that first character me, and the second character you could call the elders. Once again, it was someone who saw a Jew in need was obviously going to help them. He too went along on the other side. And then came the Samaritan. Now this is, remember, the man that Jew would have said, you're a dog under my feet. Not worthy to help. I'm not even going to walk through your city. I'm going to go around it because I cannot stand you that much. Of all the people who, we can quote in human terms, had a right to look at him and say, not helping you. It was the Samaritan. But notice what it said. It said, seeing him, he had compassion. That's in verse 33. If you look up there. He had compassion. This man should have been my enemy, but he's hurt. He's dying. He's wounded. He needs help. He didn't see an enemy. He didn't see an arrogant person, which he had every right to see both of those things. What he saw was someone who needed help. And he helped him. Jesus, trying to teach this lesson, was trying to teach the Jews a valuable thing. The Jews have become so arrogant. They looked down upon anyone that wasn't a Jew. And even the Samaritans technically were sort of half Jew, you could say. They had some Jewish heritage. They still believed in the same God and basically the old law. And yet prejudice, hatred, put a barrier between them. And this man overlooked it. He overlooked it. You know, we talked this morning about what type of prejudice do we have. Sometimes I think maybe in the religious world, our religious prejudices are the worst. We look at people of other faith and we look down on them. Well, why do they believe this? Well, that's ridiculous. That's not in the Bible at all. And sometimes anyone we talk to, we talk down to.
I've been guilty of that as I was younger, for sure.
I didn't know, why would you believe this? And I would get angry and frustrated of the lack of understanding of the Bible. That's not what Christians should do.
And you know what? I never converted anybody when I behaved that way either.
We're supposed to have compassion. If we love them enough to talk to them about the Bible, we're not going to insult them. We're going to let them turn to the Bible and let them see for themselves what they need to know that God wants them to do. And we're going to give them the opportunity to obey God. I think sometimes we feel like, well, I'm going to force them. You can't force a relationship.
And it was a time when I was younger, Jean and I, we had broken up and we were dating other people.
They call them friends, but when they set you up for a date, sometimes I don't know how much of a friend they are. My poor friends would set me up for these dates, and I would go and I'd go out on the date, and that was terrible. There was nothing about the two of us that got along at all. And you're thinking, what kind of friend are you to put me on this kind of relationship with somebody? You see, you can't, no matter how bad this one guy, he said, I just wanted you part of the family. He was dying, found out she was his cousin. Didn't tell me that until after we went out. But he can't force people to love each other. It has to come from you. It has to come from you. And when God tells us to love our enemies, the only person who can make that change is you. Let's continue looking on that. But drop down to verse 34. Right after he says he has compassion, he went to him. He bound up his wounds, pouring oil and wine, giving up things of value. Oil and wine for the Samaritan was giving up things of value that he purchased. Maybe he had just come back from purchasing these goods. He's giving up things that he very himself would have needed for someone that he did not know. It goes on and says, he bound up his wounds and he set him on his own animal. In other words, here, I'm going to put you up here. I'm going to walk. Nowadays, we don't have to do that. We can stick him in a car. He was willing to give up valuable things of his own, time of his own, effort of his own to walk. Go in. He stayed there with him. And the next morning, he says, here's extra money. Take care of him. And when I come back through, I'll pay you. Now, believe it or not, a lot of societies, that would have been, I guarantee you, if he went back through, he would have paid what was rightfully his. I remember when I was in Russia in the 90s, and I learned my whole life, you know, Russia, for me, it was USSR. For you all the people, you know that what we're talking about. Oh, you can't trust them, they hate us, blah, blah, blah. Got over there and found out none of that was true. Wonderful people. But one of the things I'll probably die and never forget is we got on a bus. Now, these buses were made to hold about 50 people. There was about 450 on it. Wasn't quite that bad, but it was so bad that people were like this with the doors closed halfway on them, both in the front and the back. We got on and we're squished like this. If an American get off the bus without a ticket, they're immediately arrested. Well, the only way you get a ticket is at the front of the bus. And I'm panicking. I can't buy a ticket. She said, sure you can. Here, she tapped this guy on the shoulder and said something in Russian. She turned and said, give him some money. So I pulled out some, how much does it need? And it was like a nickel in our money. But so many rubles in it. I said, all I've got to say. She said, that's fine. Handed him as far as the room. I looked at my dad. I said, you know, we're never getting that back. It passed all the way to the front of his bus. They bought my ticket. And they passed it and every penny of my change back. People who I had been taught through the 70s and 80s were terrible people. We're bad people. We're cruel people. I found out we're very good, honest people. How many of us today could get on a bus in New York City and pass a $20 bill and see if we could get it back? Maybe we would, maybe I'm wrong. But you see, sometimes we judge people poorly by what we've heard, what we think, and we never give them a chance to prove they're more than we think they are. God knows how valuable they are. That's why Christ died. Should we not give people that same amount of value? It goes on and says in verse 38, he asked this man that asked the question, he says, so, who do you think was a neighbor? Was it the priest? No. Was it the Levite? Absolutely not. Notice this man, and I've always paid attention to the answer. He didn't say it was the Samaritan. Because that probably ground his teeth that Jesus had used such a person for this example. He said, I suppose the one that helped him. You know that was hard. That's why he didn't just jump up. Oh, it was the Samaritan. Yay for him. Well, I suppose, I guess, it was that guy. Christ says, you're going to do the same. Can you imagine the slap in the face to the Jewish audience who just heard him say, you go act like that Samaritan acted, and you treat people with love, with compassion, with understanding. But that's what he taught. You go and do likewise. Let's look at a few scriptures here. And we'll bounce kind of quick. I don't know if you can follow, but Romans 13:9 says, for this you know, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And if there is any other commandment that sums it up by saying this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You see, if we're loving our neighbors ourselves, we're not worrying about murdering and stealing and coveting. Why? Because we're treating them with the love, compassion, and respect they deserve. You see, when we say, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, if we're not loving our neighbors, we're not doing that anyway. In 1 Corinthians 13:13, we read this morning, there's faith, hope, love, but the greatest of these is love. Because brothers and sisters, how can we say we have faith in God without love? And brothers and sisters, there is no hope without love. Because it was love that sent Jesus to this earth. It was love and compassion that God gives us on a daily basis that lets us continue to have the opportunity to obey him and have hope of heaven with him someday. Without love, there's no hope. And there's no true godly faith. People who run around and say, oh, I'm a Christian, but we hate this people, we hate it. Show me the Bible. Well, that was Jesus' attitude. He went to Samaria. He actually broke this rule. When he traveled from Galilee, he said he traveled through Samaria, something a Jew should not do. And when he got to Samaria, remember the lady at the well, the woman at the well, and he talked to her for a while, said, can I have a drink? And she would say, how would you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan, for a drink? You hate us. You won't speak or work with us at all. And you ask me for a drink. So you see, he understood. No prejudice. Because he knew he was there the day that God breathed the breath of life into man. That whether they were a Jew or a Samaritan or Roman, whether they were following God or whether they were pagan, they were God's people that he had created and that he had sent him to help save. Continue looking at some scriptures again in Galatians 5:14. It says, for the whole law is fulfilled in one word in this statement, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. James 2:8. If however you are fulfilling the royal law according to scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You see where we're constantly writing after writing is trying to teach us to love each other the way God intended for us to begin with. And we had time, we don't have time tonight, and I know I went over this morning, but I was just so excited to get to preach again, you just don't know. Go all the way back to Cain and Abel. The first two brothers, one's jealousy caused him to kill his brother. You see, love can be taken away so quickly with a bad heart. But you know who controls your heart? You do. There comes a point in every one of our lives that you can't blame mom and dad anymore. We can't blame our neighbors, our friends, because who chose those friends? You did. Our choices and our decisions are made based upon our hearts. And if we need to purify our heart, it's going to be a process, but it can be done through Jesus Christ. But we have to try. Continue looking at scriptures. In Matthew 5:43-44, we read this morning, we'll read it again.
It says, you have heard it said that you shall love your neighbor but hate your enemy. But I say, you love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. See, that's when we had the separation. Love your neighbor, but you can hate your enemy. But according to the story of the Good Samaritan, where's the enemy? It was the Samaritan and the Jew. We can't hate our enemies. We have to love them. And as I said this morning, it may be one of the most difficult teachings in the Bible to say you must love your enemies. To love those that you know hate you. And he tells us to forgive. That's hard to forgive when you know the person you're forgiving doesn't want your forgiveness. But God says, as Christians, his children, we forgive. We love because God loved us. A few more scriptures here. In Luke 6:27, but I say to you, who hear, love your enemies and do good to those who hate you. Luke 6:35 says, but love your enemies, do good, and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and your sons will be the Most High, for himself is kind to ungrateful and evil men. And then again, we read this morning, but it says in Matthew 5:46, for if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? It's easy to love those that love us. It takes effort to go beyond. The other day, I think part of our problem and lack of understanding is love is we've kind of destroyed the word. We use the words love and hate to stuff. I love pizza. Really? Love is something that we can share with each other. Jeannie and I were talking this afternoon. There's lots of kind of loves. Maybe I need to have a sermon on that, the different types of loves. I love my wife in a way and manner that I do not love anyone else in this room. Sorry, Bert, I know that hurts. But at the same time, Jeannie was talking about how many people have texted her, called her, or just told her to her face, I love you, over the last couple of days. There's nothing in the world like knowing that you're loved. And especially when it's someone that has no other reason to love you except they just want to. No other reason. You may not have any other special bond, and maybe you're just fellow Christians. Maybe you've got a relationship or friendship that you've met through work, and love has become a part of that. There's nothing greater than to know you are loved. Maybe you may not know Courtney and Tyler that were here this morning, or Tyler better known as Steve, because we didn't know his name, so we just named him Steve. I love those two kids. There's a lot of you here that love those two kids. And they always tell us they love us. They're not my kids. I didn't raise them. But I love those kids. As I look around this audience, I can tell you a lot of you. You've been through me through thick and thin, the good times and bads, and you still love me. And sometimes that's what gets us through. That's why God gave us a family. If we can learn, I joke about this all the time, we have SEC going on all over the place here. Well, then there's a Florida State guy up here. But if you can learn, you Alabama fans and Mississippi fans and Tennessee fans and Florida State fans, can, I love it when I sit here in football season, they've all got on their different colors and they're all in the huddle just to talk. You see, we can't overcome prejudices when our heart is right. We as Christians just have to make sure our heart is right. Is any of you not yet a Christian? We never want to leave. One of the things, I think Sean brought it up, and Brian brought it up on Zoom. We were together, but we weren't connecting in some ways. It's different when we're here, one with another. I don't know, maybe for some of you it was easier to put it up on chat window, you know, pray for me for this. Maybe it's because it's hard to come down here. But I'm one of those personal people. If I'm hurting, I need to talk to somebody, not shoot them a text. If I need prayers, I'm going to go ask them personally, will you pray for me? Because that way I know that they're praying for me. Tonight, maybe you need prayers.
I don't even need to know why. Maybe you're struggling. Maybe there's problems at work or within the family or friendships or literally neighbors. It doesn't matter. God's here to help us through whatever struggles the world brings us. Come forward tonight. And I've said it before, if you're scared to come forward by yourself and grab your neighbor, if you don't want to grab them, raise your hand. Now raise your hand in an invitation. I'm coming to you. But I'll come to you and I'll walk here with you. But let your family pray for you and pray with you to get you through whatever struggles you're facing. If you're not a Christian, I told y'all on one of the videos that one of the last good conversations I had with Bob was he talked about his conversion to Christianity, his life. He talked about being baptized right here in Baptist Church by me. And I remember he looked up at me and he grinned and he said, "Well, you must have done a good job because I feel good." Now, what he meant was, he was ready to die. He felt good because he knew in his heart there was a home waiting for him. And he was ready to go so that he could spend an eternity with that wife he'd already spent over 77 years with. And he's given Jenny and me and I and my boys a reason to work even harder because I want to be with him too. But if you do not give away the gospel, it's a blessing for eternity you'll miss. If you're saying, "I love the people here, I love everybody so much," then why don't you want to spend an eternity with us? It's something worth working for. Greater than anything else you'll ever do, heaven is worth working for. So you know what you need to do. And you're ready to obey the gospel, don't put it off any longer. I want you someday to be able to say the same thing. You're ready. You feel good. Because you know you obey. Tonight, whether you need the prayers of the church, or you're ready to obey the gospel, when you come, heaven stands.